I actually work with Delhi Network of Positive People. I've worked with them right from the inception. And Delhi Network of Positive People is a very interesting stakeholder on the debate on innovation itself. The positive community has involved itself, for example, in the CD4 dipstick project, which is basically a simplification of the CD4 testing, which will probably revolutionize AIDS treatment further. Having said that, I think we must acknowledge that policy plays a big role in innovation. And I'm just going to highlight what we feel, how we must balance policy on innovation. So the three aspects of policy that I'm going to comment upon and basically look at what are the incentives for people to invest in certain kind of research which is needed in developing countries, which is not market-oriented necessarily. So you may not be able to commercialize it or profit from it in terms of money, but you would probably benefit from it in under a public health program. So what are the incentives? Number two, what are the other frameworks do we have? A domestic policy that looks at how do we scale up production, how do we support production? Number three, for things like clinical trials, what is the policy in India? These are several areas of policy that are under different ministries. So I'll highlight what we feel are certain drawbacks or the problems with policy. Funding, of course, is a big issue. So people do not want to fund research which is not commercial. So looking for a TB dipstick is not very high up in a company's agenda or even in public-funded research agendas across the world. So what we see is that because it's not commercial, it's not market-oriented, no one really wants to do the research. So it's not that we can't find the biomarker or we can't find the antigen for a TB test, but there's not enough political or policy will to be able to do it. So there's absence of political and policy will to be able to do it. Number two is even if you look at clinical trials, it's a market-oriented situation. So if you look at the members of parliament, if you look at our honorable minister, Mr. Kapil Sibal, they said this is a market, this is a 2 billion market that Indians must capture. And we were in a race with the Africans and the Latin Americans to capture the clinical trial market. Unfortunately, what we did, we lost out, was that we were not able to come up with a clinical trial policy that benefited public health. So what about the trials that never get done? For example, some of the newer TB drugs, trials. What about adapting and doing the pediatric trials for HIV? I'm talking from my own experience. There must be many, many such illustrations. And lastly, because we fail to do these trials ethically, trial after trial will get shut down. I have no doubt that even if a trial which is of value, if we do it unethically, there's no way we can move forward with those trials. So the ethical framework itself is absent. We treated it as a market. We did not look at what trials would benefit our public health programs. And in the end, we are in the middle of a very big mess where we can't get the trials that we need to get done. And we're in the process of trying to shut down the trials that are already ongoing because they're very, very market-driven. They're being done unethically. Number three is the issue of transparency and governance, which is not spoken about quite a lot in the innovation circle. I'm going to talk about it because at every meeting that is relating to innovation, and I must say that CSIR or NISTAD is not guilty of that, but nevertheless, the department, DBT and Department of Science and Technology doesn't feel the need to call groups like Doctors Without Borders or Delhi Network of Positive People to any of the policy decisions that it makes on research and development. So it decided to go ahead with a bill that basically promoted the patenting of public-funded research. Experiences from the United States already spoke about the negative implications of such a policy. So only at the zero hour, at the time when it was to be introduced, we were able to get a copy and critique it. So we became adversaries to the ministry instead of actually stakeholders in the whole debate. So it's very unfortunate that a discussion with the ministry is very adversarial at the moment. Apparently, both the secretaries are not very comfortable having a conversation or answering even an RTI. They're basically flouting the law by not even answering a question through an RTI. And that's predominantly because they don't view patients as stakeholders. And I think this is a very critical factor. And I can tell you from my experience of working with the feminist movement or working with the health movement, we do have very, very big dreams about innovation. And for example, a simple to do pap smear would be so much easier for us to diagnose cervical cancer in women. To have the easier TB test is a dream that a lot of us have. Similarly, CD4 dipstick, viral load dipstick, you know, the simplification of PCR technology is a very big dream that we have, because PCR technology in every field, whether it's you apply to chikungunya or you apply to diagnosing pediatric AIDS, cost us thousands of rupees when we repeat each test. But none of that has actually played a role in policy making. And these are all doable projects. Unfortunately, these are not in the framework of a blockbuster drug. You're not talking about blockbuster drug. And the framework for discussion has always been the blockbuster drug. And I think we must actually not keep falling into the trap. Sometimes it's just about adapting a particular technology like PCR and then opening up avenues to access to that technology. So that's been a bit of an experience. But predominantly, we are fighting a losing battle on access. So we can't even think about taking up ambitious projects on innovation because we're predominantly trying to protect the space for domestic production of generic medicines. And while MSF does talk about the need to protect drugs going out of India, it is also very well aware that the patenting of a hepatitis C drug has stopped it from treating people who are co-infected with hep C in India. So pegylated interferon is highly expensive. It costs us hundreds of dollars for each treatment, each dose. And our own patients in India, we are not being able to scale up hep C treatment for people living with HIV because the drug is patented in India. And we find that less and less companies are interested in making the newer molecules, the newer drugs that we think are going to be important for TB, HIV, and other diseases. So we are very worried about India. Does India have a policy? Does it have a policy to protect generic production? Most policy discussions are about managing intellectual property, and not about how do we safeguard the policy for generic production. Currently, we're fighting the free trade agreements because each and every one of them have a provision that will not only impact access but will impact research. So intellectual property provisions which impact access also do impact research. And I think that's, people must not forget that you know, research itself is hindered by intellectual property, and there is a need to discuss how we want to change that paradigm. However, at this point of time, we don't see how anything ambitious can come up besides the CSIR project, unless we have a very concrete dialogue with the Ministry of Science and Technology. The Ministry of Commerce and Ministry of Health, I must say, have opened up dialogue in a big way. And kudos to them that Ministry of Commerce, which was till now not accessible to patient groups, has been talking very closely to patient groups on the free trade agreements. And I think there has been a policy shift, and we've seen some very problematic provisions like data exclusivity go out of the window. Because of the fact that Ministry of Commerce decided to work with civil society and the technical expertise that civil society did offer at that point of time. For me, it's a big disappointment not to have Ministry of Science and Technology on the policy table with us. Having said that, I would like to just very quickly wind up and just say two things that came to my mind. Civil society organizations are going ahead to try and fund and implement projects on innovation, like the CD4 dipstick. And I would encourage people to look at some of these projects and learn about them. And we can also share information about that. I think it makes a very good collaboration between research institutions in India and civil society otherwise. The one thing that did come up in a discussion early in the morning, and I just thought very quickly I would comment, is that this whole discussion on e-health and e-cloud has been done in Canada and United States, but not with a lot of success. We are not being able to, at this point of time, do simple things like manage a drug procurement system and actually IT manage that, the warehousing and all of it. And you're talking about computerizing and centralizing all information. I think we're talking too big. We're not even getting the simple things done. And the other issues that I think are very grave, confidentiality. You're centralizing all information. Do you offer, for example, people living with HIV, what about their medical records? Are they going to be kept confidential? I'm an asthma patient. Are my medical records going to be offered to industry to, for them to sell products to me? This whole thing of drug advertising, really, really, I think there are issues to be dealt with when we talk about centralizing medical records. There's another issue that was discussed, which was something that I've just started to work with, and I don't offer myself out as an expert. And the issue is of vaccines. And yes, MSF is very guilty of looking at combination vaccine, but it was not because Gavi offered us money or, you know, we were offered any incentives to adopt combination vaccines. We adopted it because of certain field conditions that we came across. Difficulties of vaccinating children and losing them for the second dose and the third dose, or trying to get them in for several vaccines at the same time. We do have safety and efficacy data on it. We are not at all lobbying at the central level for any kind of vaccine policy change in India, because we don't believe that this is a debate we should interfere with in India. India's got to have its own policy on vaccines and go about dealing with what it wants to introduce. However, I must say that the debate is not about a combination vaccine. The debate is whether we should have the HIP vaccine, should we have a hepatitis B vaccine, and how should we introduce it. I think if we cross those discussions, then we can decide whether we want a combination vaccine or we want something else. Interpretation of data is very different. I hear two very different sides, and I actually respect both sides. So I think there needs to be a dialogue on the HIP vaccine and the hepatitis B vaccine. The reason why I'm saying is this, that all discussions on the hepatitis B vaccine have come to a halt. The reason being that I come from a group that is very vulnerable to hepatitis, which is people living with HIV and drug users. And we've been wanting the hepatitis B vaccine. We've been wanting the hepatitis B vaccine, access to the hepatitis B vaccine for a long time. But unfortunately, in all the policy debates, it's been so adversarial and so bitter that even patient groups are not being allowed access to those places where these discussions are starting to happen. And I think the problem is that you're marginalizing the people who themselves who need to be part of the discussion. And I think in vaccines, we must actually have a very clear and open debate within civil society and actually resolve some of the bitter differences I think we have. Having said that, I think the one positive thing that has happened is that I don't know what OSDD will achieve or not achieve. I think, you know, the proof will be in the pudding when we actually eat it 10 years down the line. But having said that, you all have opened up a big policy debate in India. And I think we must have those kind of policy debates. What kind of innovation systems do we want? Do we want a monopoly system? Do we want an IP-oriented system? Do we want to manage IP better? And I think inadvertently, you have started a debate within policy circles. And I think that debate must go on and must be fostered. We must have more debates with the scientists and the patient community and policymakers on the same table, within the auspices of CSIR. I think it's not only to deliver the drug, but also to find the space for these policy and debates to happen. I think it's very important that OSDD has started this debate. And if anyone wants more information on the work that Doctors Without Borders has done on innovation, a lot of it is available online. But also, we are in touch with a lot of groups who are doing CD4 test, dipstick, and all of that. So I end on that note. Anybody who wants more information can contact us or my colleagues for that. Thank you.